Welcome to the School of Architecture. I'm Mark Robbins, the Dean, and I've been asked to let those of you who are standing know that there's also overflow seating in the cafe. So if you get tired of standing, that's an option. If just looking out here, does anybody have an open seat next to them? Would you raise your hand? Good. So there are this many seats. Look, you're so shy. Come, sit. I'm okay. I got to be home early for dinner. Okay. It's really wonderful to have David Rockwell come today. In the structure of the lecture, we're going to diverge a little bit from what we've done before. And David's going to speak about his recent work, and then we'll show a few short films. And then we'll do we'll have a discussion, he and I, and then we'll open it up to the audience. So think about questions as we're going through. Afterwards, there'll be a book signing for David's new book, Spectacle, in the gallery, and there's a reception, and you're all invited as well. In an interview a few years back in the New York Times, David Rockwell is quoted referring to the grand lobby space of Radio City Music Hall as a kind of ballet master, and it reminded me of the Paris Opera, where in fact the show is really the people moving back and forth, there to be seen, certainly as much as the show that's on stage. And it's not surprising then to find David partnering with the choreographer, Jerry Mitchell, for his project for the new JetBlue Terminal. David analyzed these flows by someone that makes dances. He describes in an anecdote the choreographer dancing in slow circles around a table. And it was this sense of the choreographer that people move in more curvilinear modes that began to suggest an architecture that would resonate really with the Saarinen and TWA building to which it's attached. And so this generated an architecture which escaped the generally banal quality of airport interiors with strands of sinuous forms that suggest in fact, the way people will move through the space. So that said, I'd like to say something iconoclastic. In reading more about David, he is a modernist. I've said it. And he learns as much from modernism as he does from Las Vegas. And don't be thrown off by the virtuosic display and theatricality, the material palette, which is fabulous, and the intensity of craft. It's not work that's stylistically driven, except when it's meant to be. And though these distinctions, I think, have little impact on the way David works and thinks about the meaning of his projects, he expects, like a modernist, that architecture can orchestrate and participate in daily life and heighten moments of ritual. Like the work of Rem Koolhaas, who in Delirious New York celebrated the radical juxtaposition of program and use and then finds forms to accommodate them, David's work is anchored in lived experience. David's a graduate of Syracuse University, and I'm pleased also on our advisory board. He began his firm Rockwell Group in 1984, and his projects include an extravagant array of buildings and building types, from hotels to restaurants. Many of these you've seen and experienced, like the W Hotels, the restaurants Nobu, Town, Country, buildings like the Kodak Oscar Theater, the Mohegan Sun Casino, the Motown Museum with ARO, and the new spa with Richard Branson. Then there's the work on stage, a theater for Cirque du Soleil, set designs for Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, and Hairspray, among others. He's recently produced a new line of wall coverings of stitched leather and sets of glassware and decorative objects. His work has been recognized by the Society of Interior Designers, and he's a recipient of the President's Design Award. He's also working here in Syracuse on Syracuse stage. David has always been interested in theater. His mother was a performer, I think vaudeville, and as a boy, he recounts putting on shows with his brother. And perhaps now, enhanced or encouraged by his own young children, he's become increasingly focused on play and its necessity in daily life. We can see this in his current project for a park at South Street Seaport, in which he's partnered with a number of collaborators. David often collaborates, both with architects, with designers, in the most generous way. But he also brings people in who have nothing on the surface to do with architecture, and I think that's what distinguishes the work. In this case, he's partnering with people from City College who deal with early child behavior. The park is an abstract series of ramps and a figure eight which separates islands of water and sand. There are no cartoon characters or stock kids' environment features. Though he designs quite explicit playgrounds for grown-ups, one writer says, the narrative here is open. It's reminiscent of the thinking which informs design studios here at school or of early childhood education with Froebel blocks whose creative, open-ended play with form were famously said to have influenced Frank Lloyd Wright. This is play at the urban environmental scale. This park is a model that the city hopes to replicate in other boroughs. And again, it's based on developmental theories about engagement in social fantasy and play. Consistent with his fascination for people and spaces, Spectacle, his book with noted graphic designer Bruce Mao, demonstrates the vast variety of human interaction, the rich complexity of often fleeting communal activities, from NASCAR to the running of the bulls in Pamplona to the Harbin Ice Festival. The book presents, as David says, the shared lived experience that transforms not only the way we see the world, but also, and this is important, how we see each other. This fuses a group of strangers into an instant community. Think of the last time you were in a parade or voted, enacting your publicness with a group of people you may or may not know. One of my first meetings with David took place in New York a few years ago. We'd planned to meet at his office at Union Square, but the location had to be changed. So we met at David's other workplace at the time, the Imperial Theater. And in a scene that I can only say was right out of a Warner Brothers 1930s Busby Berkeley musical, I walked into a dim theater with John Lithgow and Joanna Gleason running around on stage doing rehearsals of curtain calls, technicians clustered with earbuds around directors who I imagined were giving copious notes. I asked for David, and I was directed to the second balcony, where in the comforting velvet of the darkened theater, we talked about, of all things, you all, architecture, education, and what we were doing as designers. This all punctuated by the patters of actors below us on the lit stage. In thinking back, it's really David who understands the cues, sequence, lighting, sound, the ways we plot our steps and experience, just like the ballet master of the spaces he admires. It's with great pleasure that I welcome David Rockwell.
This on? Is that good? Thanks for that amazing introduction. And it's bizarre that I walk back onto the campus of Syracuse and immediately feel like a student who's going to get an incompletion. I think about my early experiences here, and I'm gonna try and divide the talk into two pieces, one focused on the book that Mark mentioned, Spectacle, and the other on current work that we're doing right now. And so much of what fueled my experience here was about the thrill and the terror of discovery and of not knowing the answers before I began. And so much of what guided this book that I'm going to show you was a kind of discovery. So in some ways, it's fitting that we talk about it in a collaborative way. And then I'm going to try and make a loose transitional link, as Mark might say, theatrically between the book and our work. You know, I came to Syracuse with a love of theater, and I came here with a love of architecture, and I never in my wildest dreams imagined they'd be intersecting in the way they get to intersect in our work. And I feel like, for me, the challenge is to keep inventing that newness and to keep from getting inside a comfort zone where you know the answers before you begin. So I'm going to, I guess, turn those off and dim this a little bit. In developing this book, in showing it to you today, one of the questions that that I wanted to just discuss briefly is where the interest in this book began. It began long before developing a specific book proposal. My interest in live events and in the subject of the book began as a kid in the suburbs of New Jersey, where my mom was a dancer early on in vaudeville, and we were part of the community theater. In the suburb I lived in New Jersey, was all about privacy. Everything was private homes, private lawns, except for, and it's right out of Waiting for Guffman, the community theater, which was a place where there was an exchange of ideas, and there was this, I thought, fascinating ability to tell stories. And the stories were told visually, and they were told orally, and it was about collaboration. When I was 11, we made this sudden transition to Guadalajara, Mexico. And there was no real explanation as a kid about what we were doing. But what was incredible for me and what was so life-giving is Mexico was the New Jersey suburbs turned inside out. There was no private realm, teeny houses, but extraordinary marketplaces, incredible bull rings, great museums. And what I was most struck by wasn't any one building, but it was the rituals that connected all of those pieces. And that fascination continued and was tolerated and embraced here at Syracuse. However, as I got clearer on what I was focused on and interested in, which now many, many years later I can post-rationalize and look at and put words to, and as a student I wasn't able to, is the community-driven experience that fuels the life that happens within buildings. And there wasn't a lot of language for that at school, and it was a kind of yearning that I was able to articulate more clearly with this book. So I put together a thought process, and Fiden, actually the publisher, first approached me about doing a book on theater history and on buildings. And I started to think about, how does theater behave when you multiply it by 1,000 or 100,000? What is it, as a designer, could I hold a lens up to this vast world of rituals and festivals, some of them new, some of them 4,000 years old, to extract a common language? How do they behave? How do they feel? What's it like to be there? I put together a small editorial board. I spoke to Bruce Mao, who was interested in coming on board, and that was fascinating because the book is a look at experiences that, by definition, I'm saying you have to be at. So how do you visually represent experiences that need to be participated in? And for the purposes of this book, I'm sure everyone here, after spending many all-nighters, has their own definition of spectacle. For the purposes of our book, we have a very narrow definition of what we were looking at. And it's live, participatory, man-made events that in some ways turbocharge everyday reality. That was our focus. And I found 20 big picture thinkers who were interested in participating in the book. Julie Taymor, John Waters, who interestingly says that as a kid, his mom used to say, don't make a spectacle of yourself. And the only parade he would tolerate is if he was on LSD at a drag queen parade. Wasn't a big proponent of parades. Quincy Jones, Muhammad Ali, people who are in the world of creating these events, because my interest was not taking the 3,000 foot in the air, neat analytical view of it, but I wanted to get down into the messy business of it. And as someone who lives in New York, the city looks very neat from the air. It's all, you know, a kind of neat Cartesian grid. But you get down on the ground and it's much messier and much more vital. And that was the view I wanted to take. So we, the book is a weave that takes the primary narrative, and the primary narrative asks two questions. What are spectacles and what do they do? Well, excellent. Spectacles are big, bold, and they're brief, and they connect, and they transform, and they immerse. The primary book looks at those six qualities, and then is a series of sidebars that allow us to look at ideas around the idea. Cedric Price, the abuse of spectacle, the darker side. We got to create this kind of weave through the thing, and that was the structure. I'm going to take you on a quick tour of the book to give you a sense of the experience. So spectacles are big, and they're big on a scale that is somewhat unfathomable. This is a look at Kumbh Mela, which is a 3,000-year-old Hindu bathing ritual that takes place every 3 years, and every 12 years there's a mega Kumbh Mela. What we are looking at here are photographs from 2001. 70 million people participated. 25 million people bathed in the Ganges River in one day. And the event was only recognizable as a figure from a satellite. It was so large, as you can see here. Here's what was interesting. We interviewed Nick Day, who made an extraordinary film about Kumbh Mela. And what I was fascinated with is the systems, the temporary pontoon bridges, which we're now looking at using in New York for a festival there. But the organic, intuitive systems that were so peaceful around organizing this kind of mass group. On a more familiar level, spectacles are big and huge in a way that transforms everyday reality. And I found it fascinating to look at events like the Thanksgiving Day parade, in which these mammoth balloons shrink the scale of the city. So by contrast, they transform our perception of reality. Anyone here know Simon Doonan, creative director of Barney's? Really, really an interesting artist. He's Jonathan Adler's partner. And we spoke to him about boldness. And he describes the human natural attraction to exuberance. This is actually something that I made a film of. And if we have time, we can show that little film. But I went over there with three filmmakers and myself because I wanted to look at the Brussels flower carpet in person. Started in 71. It's a relatively new ritual. It takes the Grand Place in Brussels, these beautiful, handsome, sober facades, and then electrifies them with a million begonias that are extraordinarily beautiful and in total contrast to the surrounding. And the kind of boldness in some ways reframes the city. Spectacles are also brief. And it's one of the, I think, most, as a designer, one of the humblest things that I learned from doing this book is some of our deepest memories are based on experiences that are ephemeral. And in fact, fleeting can be more kind of emotionally gratifying. In the case of fireworks, we're talking about art that disappears as it's being made, literally disappears. And I also thought it was an interesting example in looking at many of the events in the book is it exists right on the edge between control and out of control. So, you know, if you look at fireworks, it's essentially controlled warfare. And our attachment to it is about the kind of amazing visual quality that disappears. We did a kind of analysis and worked with the Grucci's, which was a fantastic learning experience for me, about the different ways fireworks are grouped and the way they're choreographed. Spectacles are big, they're bold, they're brief, and they connect us. Has anyone here been to Burning Man? I gave a talk in San Francisco, and the room was full of like stoner Burning Man freaks. It was, in San Francisco, there's a lot of Burning Man. Does anyone know what Burning Man is? So for the 4 weeks that this takes place in August, the middle of the desert is transformed into the second largest city in Nevada. 35,000 people. And Larry Harvey, who's the founder, and Kevin Kelly, who's the founding editor of Wired Magazine, and paradoxically, not only into Wired Magazine, but really a huge fan of Burning Man. As we talked about it, there were a few interesting lessons, I thought. One of them was there is no audience. Everyone's a participant. So to be there, you have to participate. And the other thing is, when this is gone, everything disappears. One of the mantras of it is leave no trace. So from a sustainability point of view, it's interesting to think that this appears and disappears every year, and everyone's a participant. Spectacles transform, and that's somewhat self-evident, but what's not quite so evident to me, or wasn't before we did this, is we spent some time in Trinidad with a guy named Peter Menschel. And for any of you interested, he's very available. He's the guru of Carnival out of Trinidad. And what's so extraordinary is spectacle transforms a community. So if you look at the 3 months before Carnival and the thousands of people who participate, who pay money to make their own costume, it's the opposite of the financial exchange in theater. You pay to participate. So you have the anticipation, you have the event, and then you have the resonance of the event. But you also have the personal transformation of anyone who participates and gets to change who they are to be part of this event. So this was a fascinating journey with Peter. This is 1963, where Martin Luther King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech. It looks at the mall in Washington as a place of transformation, as a place about transforming. The last image was the AIDS quilt. So it's a constantly changing space that's able to contain this wide variety of messages. And the last sort of major heading in the book is spectacles immerse. I love these images. And this is the Holi Festival, which is also an ancient spring Hindu festival where you purchase dried flowers from the market, and then they're strewn on buildings, animals, the ground. You literally, sight, sound, color, every one of your senses is transformed through this experience. The end of the book, the last chapter is called Getting There, and it looks at 100 events around the globe, 40 of them in more detail, and it invites people to go out and participate and experience kind of sense of being there. And should I show this little 2-minute film? So we made a 2-minute film that takes the ideas of the books and put it in 3 dimensions that might give you a sense of it. And then I'm going to move on to some current work. And this is great with the volume up really loud.
Yeah.
Thank you.
you know, I think it's fascinating in living in a world where we're so connected by technology in the process of the book to look at why do we still need to be with other people? Why do we still need events that bring us together? And my office is on Union Square overlooking this wonderful square that actually the day the book was released, there was this huge protest. I couldn't get out of the office, and I was thinking, what the hell are these people doing here? And I realized it was sort of ironic that I was annoyed by a spectacle that was blocking me. But the space transforms daily, and the my practice and what I'm interested in is creating places that allow for public discussion, that allow for a kind of connection that that physical space can do. The first project I'm going to show is not coming up now, but there we go. It's a restaurant in the St. Regis for a chef named Alain Ducasse, who's an extraordinarily celebrated French chef. And he had come to New York 6-7 years ago with a restaurant in the Essex House that was the height of formality and uniformly rejected by New York. And this is a chef with 16 Michelin stars, probably the most celebrated chef in the world. That restaurant closed, and he came to us with a request that we create a wine-centric restaurant. So we created this restaurant called Adore, which takes this space that's not a landmark space, but it's a wonderful space. And within that, we created a layered, rich room that references the layers of wine and is all about the ritual of serving wine. So if you had to say the relationship of theater in a restaurant to me, it's that in theater you have a script. In a restaurant or a hotel, you extract the script. Is this going to go back to the other part, or is it just going to?
Yes.
It will. So we have four decanting stations in the corner of the room that anchor it. And then what you're looking at is this technology piece we developed called the Interactive Sommelier that's motion sensitive. And there's 1,000 bottles of wine that you can explore through technology. And then when you get in the room, we've got this glass that I spent 2 years developing. It's three layers of seeded glass with a film in it that is backlit. And then there's 1,500 temperature control bottles, each case individually controlled to the temperature he wanted. And then as the culminations, there's this this technology piece. It's quite wonderful and really interesting balance between not having this be like an iPhone where people just sit there and do it. But what happens is you pick the kind of wine you want and you can self-select it. And the thing people love the most is we have a piece where you can press share and it sends it to the person next to you. So it's a new kind of wine pickup strategy. And that rendering in the upper right, the guy, the sommelier, that's exactly the guy they got. He looks just like that. The next project that I want to show isn't built yet. It's called Aloft, and it's for Starwood, which is the same company that we developed W for. And it's one of two things. It's either W at a price, or it's an elevated motel. I think it's an elevated motel, and Starwood thinks it's W at a price. But it's essentially a reinvention of the select service hotel. And what I was intrigued by is if you're going to spend $100 a night or $80 a night, why can't you be in a place that has a sense of design? The key thing that we had to do was programmatically reinvent the model. Because if you're going to build a hotel for, let's say, $300,000 a key for a high-end hotel, if you're going to do it for $80,000 per key for a loft, you're going to have to take out more than finishes. You've got to compress the program. So what we did was we took the public space and made it a third the size with every piece being transformable. So where you have breakfast in the morning, all these pieces rotate and the buffet becomes the bar. The light fixtures all lower from day to night to become a place where you work or you drink and eat. The furniture is all movable. And of course, Starwood was concerned that none of the operations people would actually do this. So we built, it'll be in Metropolis next month, we built a full-scale mock-up of all the public spaces in Westchester for the operators to come in and use. We're currently working on the New York Film Society's new home at Lincoln Center. And the New York Film Society is the group that does the New York Film Festival. And most New Yorkers think Film Society is the film festival. But it in fact isn't. They have screenings 365 days a year. And it's part of the Diller Scafidio Renfro Master Plan on 65th Street. And we collaborated with them on the accommodation of the facade, and then looked at their program. So their program is a 100-seat screening room and a 200-seat screening room. And as you can see, we're underneath the Henry Moore sculpture at the State Theater. What I realized was there was an opportunity to take all of these experiences and take them out of their individual cells and link them so that they were closer to a cinematic experience that you moved through. The key breakthrough idea was, since we had to excavate to get the height for the screening rooms, we reconceived of, you can see here's the facade. The ticketing happens in this cantilevered box office. You go through concessions, and then we had to excavate to get down to the screening rooms, and we reconfigured the lobby as a bent plywood amphitheater that seats 70 people. In the back of the projection booth has a secondary screen, so during the day, throughout the day, directors can do director series, you can do shorts, so it becomes a dialogue to have a relationship with the public. I realize in looking at this, they're not conceived in any sort of way that has anything to do with each other, but that's just the way. So this is the set for Hairspray, and it was my second Broadway show, and I was with some people today who were asking about the relationship of theater and architecture for me. Theater was really the academic backbone for the architecture. It began as a research project, it began much more academically, and then within the last 10 or 15 years, I started to meet with directors and talk to them about what they needed. And what they need is transitions. They don't need people to do kind of beautiful static pictures. They need a way for the physical place to propel the narrative, to get from place to place. As I got clear about that, I thought it's a place where I could make a contribution. And the second show, the first show I got to do, I was invited, actually, I almost did one of the biggest flops in Broadway history. I was asked to do it, and I designed it. And thank God I got dinked from the project before it happened, because I'm sure it would have cured me of wanting anything to do with theater, because it was a miserable experience. My second show was Hairspray, and I began the journey by going to Baltimore with John Waters and kind of looking at his version of Baltimore. And my first meeting with the director, Jack O'Brien, who did Coast of Utopia and is a legendary director, like everyone here, I decided I would solve every design problem right up front. So I had a room full of, I had not only designed the sets, I had directed the thing. I mean, I was ready. So I had this room full of things, and I'd spent this wonderful time with John Waters in Baltimore, and I tried to channel his eccentric view of the world. And this director looked at everything and put his arm around me. And he said, let's take everything out of the room except for the three things that make you fall in love with this little chubby girl the most. And let's start with her story. And it was the best kind of critique I could have gotten, because then together we built this world. And it takes place in 1962. And it is this kind of wonderful moment where it's not quite rock and roll and it's not the 50s. There is certainly about the Saarinen Terminal and love of modernism and love of everything that's new. And it's also about the relationship between the white kids and the black kids and this girl who wants to integrate the two. And in one of the creative meetings, I was playing with a toy called Light Bright. Any of you familiar with that? It's the pegboard. And we developed this LED wall that uses found technology. This was way pre-Philips buying color kinetic. So this was 7 or 8 years ago. LED was relatively new. And there were all these architectural fixtures that had little LED nodes that weren't being used. So I vacuum formed essentially large-scale Tupperware and put these over the LED and did this low-resolution light bright wall that comes on at the moment when Tracy convinces her mom to look outside the boundaries of Baltimore to a bigger world. I think the greatest gift in our studio is, and there's about 240 people in the studio, technologists, designers, writers, is our commitment to be proactive. And I think, you know, is we really do have an opportunity as designers to impact the world and to not wait for the phone to ring and to figure out what we're passionate about and to go out there and do it. And that's a large part of what we do. And so over the years, there's been a series of, I'm going to talk in more detail about the playground, but it's really grows out of, the playground grows out of a foundation that I established after 9/11 with Kevin Kennan and Diller Scafidio Renfro, where I felt like every architect kind of talking about what should happen at 9/11 the week after it happened was really totally missing the point, and what was really needed was a way to observe what happened there. So we formed a foundation, and in 100 days built a viewing platform. And everything that's up here, DIFA, which is, if you don't know, you should find out about and get involved, is Design Industry Foundation Fighting AIDS. It's one of the country's oldest AIDS organizations, and over 23 years has given away $35 million for education programs around AIDS. And that is, all of it kind of links to the notion that as designers, we can proactively make things happen. So after the viewing platform, several of the people who had given money to the foundation said, "Do you have something you want to do next?" And I had a grand idea about an arts foundation downtown that was going to be artists living in workspace, performance, and visual arts. And I sort of loved the idea of crossing boundaries. We put together this incubator. We had major theater groups behind us, and I just couldn't get it done. Dealing with LMD, the Lower Manhattan Development Corp, and federal government, and in a moment of having raised and spent $1 million in private money for this arts foundation, in a moment of frustration, I said to Amanda Burden, who set up city planning, I should have just built a playground downtown. She said, "Well, that's not a bad idea." So 3 years late, 3 years later, after lots of research, we realized that playgrounds were the perfect opportunity to look at something that needs reinvention. It's a place where, at the moment, it largely deals with gross motor skills. It doesn't deal with creativity. And our formula, and this is a case where we are, we've raised $2 million of private money to endow this. We're building it downtown, and the city is expanding this program. And these are test play dates we've been doing over the last 3 years. The model is loose parts and allowing kids to do what they do best, which is build and create their own world, take it apart and start over. So you're looking at different prototypes of blocks that we're trying at play dates. It's a continuous landscape, multi-level, sand, water, loose parts, and the ability to make things. And that starts construction. In a month, we began with a series of workshops with kids around what they found engaging. There are also, for anyone particularly interested, Louis Kahn and Noguchi in mid-60s had proposed this extraordinary playground that never happened in Riverside Park. And the whole trend in playgrounds to be innovative kind of stopped because of insurance and because of the perception that playgrounds come out of catalogs. This is the JetBlue terminal, and my first meeting with Jerry Mitchell, who was the choreographer who I brought in, and this also did Hairspray, was on my first show, the Rocky Horror Show, and he came into the room to introduce himself and said hello, and unbuckled his pants and pulled them down and showed me a huge bruise here and here. So I didn't know what to do. It was my first Broadway show. I thought that's what choreographers do, so. I said, you know, nice to meet you. And he said, this is from teaching people to do the time warp. So he had gotten those bruises teaching people to do that. So JetBlue is building this new terminal. It's hot and late, so I'm going to speak. Is there any way you can make it cooler in here, or does everyone like it this warm? It's okay? 20 million people a year are going to go through this terminal, so it'll be more than all of LaGuardia. When JetBlue brought us on board, what they were concerned about was people movement and that they wanted to control it. I actually felt like the greatest asset we had in the terminal was the choreography of people and to elevate, lift, celebrate the move into New York. So we brought on Jerry. We started to look at the architecture of the space and looked at how could you take JetBlue's kind of core values of sense of humor, humanity, service, and not only can't the terminal be expensive, it can't look expensive. In other words, there can't be anything that looks like your dollars was going to anything other than the terminal. So we created this central kind of sculptural piece made of two bleachers that intuitively move you as you're leaving New York, deaccelerate you and move you to the outside of the sculpture. And when you're coming to New York, they accelerate you and move you through the middle to get into the speed of the city. And not only are these public seating, but at the top we have two performance spaces. One will be music, one will be art. And to deal with the kind of anxiety of air travel, we put a flight information display at the very center. So it's a central thing you see when you get there. I wanted to quickly show this work we're doing for New York City on Coney Island. And the mayor, they had been working for 2 or 3 years on how to deal with Coney Island, particularly if private developers were buying pieces of it. And they were getting very nervous that what private developers really were going to do was put mid-income condos right on the water, which it turns out that's what they were going to do. So we worked with city planning for a year and developed a master plan, which is now being used to change zoning. So this, all of Coney Island is being rezoned based on the work we did with them. And I thought what was interesting is the perception historically, for those who've seen the Rick Burns documentary, that Coney Island was one big place. Well, it wasn't one big place. It was a series of really idiosyncratic, quite small places that were part of this grid, Luna Park. So we worked on creating event zoning that would look at the programming in terms of how Coney Island is used throughout the year and created an armature for that. So this is some of the zoning analysis, and I just want to show you a few of the images that deal with essentially a land use plan that builds densest away from the water and then amphitheaters in a series of steps that makes the water the performance space. So you can see how the kind of lowest densities on the boardwalk, higher density, and then steps up, and then the most surreal component is a series of experiences that link all 8 sites and create this kind of landscape of spaces. 2 more projects to go. Nobu. Nobu is one of the great gifts you could ever expect to have as a designer, and that's like an ongoing gig with a collaborator. So for 14 years, we've been working with Nobu Matsuhisa. This is Nobu 57th Street, which just opened up. The original Nobu was based on my perception that Nobu didn't want his restaurant to be perceived as a traditional Japanese restaurant. He didn't want soji screens. He was about combining Peruvian street food with kind of couture Japanese sushi chef. And the way I start out designing a restaurant is eating the food and talking to the chef and developing a script. And he was very much interested in complex flavors with very simple presentations. So over the last 13 years, we've been able to do a series of installations for Nobu that riff on the ideas of collaboration, of craftsmanship, and of food and design, and also deal with what it's like to be at a table. The one thing Nobu cared most about in my first meeting, we had to do a full-scale mock-up, was the height of the eye of the sushi chef relative to the customer. He was very interested in that kind of visual communication. These are images of something that's under construction. You can see these abaco walls that are 40 feet tall that we designed on a computer, but are being handmade in Malaysia, that are going to create this, the kind of most surreal of the Nobus to date. And speaking of surreal, I wanted to kind of end with the most unusual thing we've had a chance to do, and that's design the sets for Team America. Has anyone seen Team America? Is it the foulest puppet movie you've ever seen? So I was at a meeting in a conference room, and I got a call saying it was Scott Rudin, who's a major Hollywood producer, and he had a script he wanted me to read. Had I ever done a movie? And I said, no, I hadn't. I read the script, and it was, anyone here know Thunderbirds, the British series that this was stylistically based on? It was a marionette thing. So it was Matt Strone and Trey Parker. They were gonna do this epic puppet movie, and did I have any ideas about how to do it? Because essentially, Matt and Trey are not primarily interested in the visual world. They're much more into kind of sort of simple storytelling. So I met with them, and I'm going to show you a clip, and then I'm going to show you some process images, which I thought might be interesting. But after reading the script, there were just two or three ideas that I proposed to them. And one was, if in fact all the marionettes are a third scale, so all these sets and some of the sets are five times the size of this room, so they're vast sets. And the cinematographer was Bill Pope, who did The Matrix. Who was up for anything. So it was really like this extraordinary opportunity to create this landscape. And I said, well, if the marionettes are only 2 feet tall, shouldn't we embed in every location one or two Where's Waldo-like images that reveal the scale of them? Shouldn't there be some riff on the fact that they're, and wouldn't it be interesting if the kind of dumb Americanized view of the world that Matt and Trey take, you know, the kind of American view of terrorism, was embedded in all of the physical environment. So the paving in Paris is made out of cast croissants. The palm trees in LA are made out of ripped money. The other idea that I proposed to them is that we used super saturated, highly detailed worlds that in some ways pick up on Ken Adams' classic design for Dr. Strangelove or some of the classic James Bond movies. So I'm going to run a clip and then show some images. This was 4 months of two all-nighters every week.
But the world is on the brink of disaster.
And just what does this have to do with me?
Last week in Paris, we got 4 terrorists with a weapon of mass destruction. We have to find out who sold it to them. Our only hope is to have somebody act like a terrorist. We need an actor. And they say you're the best.
On October 15th...
I've got 5 terrorists going southeast on Bakalakadaka Street. Soon every country will be in complete chaos.
To save the world from falling apart.
And so you see, the new world is inevitable.
It's what?
Inevitable.
One more time?
So this is a look at my original sketch for Times Square and some of the early models. We had 2 or 3 people who deal with miniature movie making. You can see everything's a yellow cab. And again, there's a kind of reductivist view. And as Marx's nod to modernism, team base is an ode to modernism. I don't know if that's in these images. This was the original set for Lisa's bedroom, where they have very X-rated sex. Matt and Trey thought it was a little too trampy, so that's what we went with. The most interesting part was negotiating with Mark Newsom to be able to use his chair. The only way we could do it was we gave him the chair from the movie. And we storyboarded this. We storyboarded the approach and the transitions from scene to scene. And I don't know, Timo, does it show team bass here? This shows Paris. This was a huge sound stage that we blew up. One of the most interesting things was dealing with perspective, and one of the ways we forced perspective was reducing the scale as it went back. So this is team base with a working waterfall and a glowing uplit floor, and this sits within this big crater. Kim Jong-il's palace. We have small missiles hanging from the lantern. Hand grenades on the sconces. Those are the palm trees in LA. Very Mussolini. A friend of mine who knows Susan Sarandon, after she saw the movie, won't talk to him or me, because she gets blown off of a balcony with an Uzi and didn't like that. So, you know, they seem radically disconnected, but for me, the thing that is constantly thrilling is being on the edge of not knowing what the next adventure is going to be. And that really feels very linked to the kind of experience that I had in school, and I suppose it's a great gift that I never unlearned that. So thanks very much. And
turn this up.
Yep.
That's great. I love seeing Team America. This is like being in the federal government. It's the hair alone is fantastic. This is a hard act to follow. It was great seeing the work and great seeing the range. Just really spectacular. And the comment about modernism is actually true. As I read through the work, even the way you talk about kind of reducing the palette, the notion of editing, when the director of your first theater project said, you know, it's just about the girl, and what can you do to support that? It really is a modernist notion of stripping away everything that's inessential in the field to get the point across, to make certain things happen. Modernism is probably not something that most people link you with because of your facility with interiors and decor and historic references. How, in fact, does your knowledge or understanding of history inform the work?
Should I use that?
Is that better that?
Yeah. Well, the part about the question that I sort of most relate to is where knowledge of history and curiosity about what preceded us in terms of design is most impactful is looking at kind of strategies. You know, when you're looking at kind of a strategic approach to design, in a lot of our work, in a door, for instance, which is layered with a series of very inventive finishes, the real key creative partie was based on work I learned in school about French hotels, and pochette, and kind of deep space. And
louder?
No, I wasn't listening. You know, we did a hotel in New York called Chambers on 56th Street. That is was our first ground-up building in the city. And it's a quite a minimalist palette. with a few extraordinarily extravagant crafted pieces. But the key part of the partie was very much based on a kind of modernist look at circulation and stair. I don't draw a distinction between those different categories. On the way over here today, I was talking to two students about the relationship of theater and architecture, and I don't really draw a distinction between the two, but I was referencing a designer who had recently done does a lot of work at the Met, who had recently done a show. And when you see the show, you realize that that environment is better without people. And I think where a kind of sense of history is most useful is around movement and circulation. And you know, I'm reading a book on Trouvet right now, and kind of continue to be the comment about Radio City Music Hall. What was most interesting about Radio City Music Hall to me was when it was built at the height of the Depression, the level of invention of Donald Esty in terms of materials and of spatial choreography, and Rem's book, as I remember it, speculates that originally for the opening they were going to pump nitrous oxide into the air conditioning system to truly simulate an evening in the country. I think that falls outside of modernism.
It certainly falls outside of what we can do in a classroom building. So this is probably as close to the actor's studio in interviews with Lipton as we'll ever get. Carol Grzeski from VPA gets closer to acting and singing every day. But the idea of choreography plays so strongly in all of your work across, from the landscape projects to projects in Las Vegas for shopping, and you're not really determined by the specific decor or the history, but there is a kind of level of attachment to narrative and understanding how people will use the space and how it unfolds. Could you say something about this sense of immersion? It's what you call immersion, which you're interested in spectacle, and what you find the relationship is between your sense of what's poignant in architecture and what you see actually in cities. New York, for instance, the new apartment buildings going up on Sixth Avenue, or the kind of the quality of day-to-day architecture in the city.
That's an essay question.
Yeah, sorry. all of the above. Yeah.
Well, I find a huge groundswell of interesting design going on outside of, anyone know Stefan Segmeister, graphic designer, who recently had a show open up downtown? Amazing show, amazing work. And I think that in general, well, I think the Herzog and Himmerer building is incredible for Ian. And there's great examples of high visibility, great architecture in the city. But I think the more interesting stuff that's happening is viral, smaller scale, and the sort of higher budget, higher risk. Like if you look at, I don't want to bash the Time Warner Center, but I may just for 1 second.
We're 5 hours away from New York.
The high budget, kind of high wire act tends to squeeze risk out of a project. And that is something I'm allergic to. So we try and stay on the periphery, and I do feel like in some ways the investigation of the spectacle is fueled by trying to, you know, this interest I've always had. Part of my interest in ephemerality is I never had an upbringing that gave me the permanence. You know, we moved a lot. My parents died when I was young. It was kind of forced transition. And part of what I've always loved about New York is its embrace of experimental. And even in theater, I think that there's the more interesting theater is happening, edgier, smaller, virally. I do think that under the Bloomberg administration, what's happening in parks is phenomenal. So I think there's a kind of rebirth of the waterfront. It is a balancing act between the needs of developers to
I was speaking to someone from the Wall Street Journal who was doing an article on residences in the city and looking at how kitchens were shrinking. And of course, the radical thing to do would be to eliminate the kitchen altogether and rethink what do people want in New York, since they're, you know, sending out for food 7 days a week. Maybe they need a different kind of room. I don't know what they do in that room.
It's interesting, you know, there's that older model, even in grand apartments in New York, you find very, very vestigial kitchens. It was understood you would, New York wasn't really a city of dining in and inviting your friends. It was really a city that you experience out in public.
Which is why hotels, became the place where,
you know, hotels in the 20s in the city took on this amazing life of kind of a public living room that you couldn't have in your apartment.
But also the point about the current interest in landscape architecture, Bloomberg has been helpful. Julie Cerniak, one of our faculty members who we know, is just did a presentation of the Architectural League. And it was Julia, Jim Horner, Ken Smith, and landscape architects were talking about the kind of current vibrancy in landscape architecture and the fact that they are now design leads. And so often in your own work, because you're not so concerned with boundaries or labels, you're able to borrow things that are of interest, whether they're from the world of art or the world of academe or from landscape architecture. Something that's also critical, maybe this is the last question before we open it up. For me, spectacle is engaging because of the complexity of images and people presented, and there's a politics to presenting that. And I think there's a deep politics to the word, which is, again, probably not what people think about first when they go to the W Hotel and they look at, you know, rich damask curtains and burl wood and really beautiful, beautiful craftsmanship, because the craftsmanship is great. But you spoke about the politics in the work, and it's not just your work with DIFA. Can you talk about the ways that you see us as architects participating with a larger voice in the public realm through our work?
Well, I think it happens on many levels. There's a kind of discourse level where I think architects more and more are having a viable seat at the table in thinking about what our cities are like. But I also, for me, the power of what we all do as designers is the ability to make things. And it's one of the things that kind of thrills me about walking around here is the amount of actual making. And I think it's, I think it's a positive statement in terms of where politics fit into our work. We have a commitment to kind of democratization. A friend of both of ours, who's an architecture critic, observed many years ago that one of the things that I was most committed to is a pluralist, not kind of assigning too much value to any one school of thought, but being willing to kind of look at a range of ideas. And as we do more work, that is the biggest challenge. The biggest challenge is not to do work that people come to us that behaves like work we've done before. So I'll give you an example in the hotel world. Has anyone heard of Toms, T-O-M-S? It's a guy named Blake Mikowski, who 4 or 5 years ago went to Argentina, and he was an investment banker. And he noticed that none of the kids had shoes, and he won the Cooper Hewitt Award last year, the People's Choice Award. I didn't know Cooper Hewitt had a People's Choice Award. But I've been working with him for 5 years, well before he was in Vogue magazine. And what worked in his Well, Siegfried's sitting over there. And I'll tell one story I told Mark that I think is so my first week here at Syracuse, I don't know if this is relevant or not, but we had to do two things. We went to hear Buckminster Fuller, who I believe was at Henry's Chapel, and I understood probably every sixth word. And then we had to go out on campus and draw something. So I had just come, I was living in Mexico, I had my huaraches, I put them at the base of a tree, and I was drawing this still life that I thought was great. And I looked over, and this kid next to me had drawn an entire kind of etching of the whole campus. It was so horribly intimidating. So I thought I had made a huge career mistake, and I said that to Siegfried. And the comment I got back was, you just have less to unlearn than anyone else. And I think part of it is figuring out what you're passionate about. So it's not like, you know, if all of the things that we're doing are things that I really care about, that we, you know, I've been lucky enough to be given those opportunities, but I think it's by keeping alive the part of you that was drawn to design to begin with, and not rubbing off the idiosyncrasies to be like other people. Many other architects, I remember the year we were inducted in the Interior Design Hall of Fame, and I remember it because I had a lot of family members there, and it was a big, huge deal. And a friend of mine who's a writer looked out, and when the editor said, and this year he designed Hairspray, he said, you could see many other architects and designers saying, man, I wish I had done Hairspray. And I was like, I think it doesn't matter. I think it's not about doing what someone else did, it's about doing what is inherently true to your interest, and honing that, and developing that, and researching that, and honoring that. And then I think once you develop that, it doesn't have to be industry specific.
First of all, I still think the change is just stuff. What kind of advice, if you were sitting around with the developers right here
in Syracuse,
and we were just talking about, you know, what would you like to see happen
in Syracuse? Guys to work together. And my response was, comes out of it. So we all worked together for a month. We met every week. And essentially, everyone developed a scheme, which they then presented to MGM. And it was for 1 million square feet on the strip. And this sort of gets a long way to answering the question. And MGM decided that the 1 million square feet should have 600,000 square feet of retail. Our proposal was, and this is what we developed, put in no retail, make it 1 million square foot park. Create the one public place in Las Vegas, make it a 3-level park. And the challenge was to go from zero on the strip to 24 where the casino is. So you had to transition over 24 feet. So 2 weeks later, we got a phone call saying, well, we'd like to see you. And I came in to see them, and they said, well, you got the job. I said, wow. They said, you got to put it in retail. We're not idiots. Well, the whole idea was to not put it in the retail. Having said that, that's what I would have done. Thank you. Well, the biggest challenge, I mean, it's a very diverse group. It's an extraordinarily diverse group that, and the biggest challenge is to not have kind of design ghettos created around people who can do a certain thing. And that's challenging, because if there's 5 or 6 people that develop, people who did chambers, for instance, we did a chambers in Minneapolis, which is both the ground up and connection of 2 buildings. And I intentionally took the team that did the original chambers off, because I didn't want it to be a cookie cutter thing. So I think part of it is being willing to allow friction. I think part of diversity is, and today was unfortunately more friction than usual in the office, but it's allowing different-minded people to work together, to have a say, and all be respected, and kind of go towards something that's bigger than any one person. And it's one of the things that I found in the research for Spectacle, is ultimately people want to participate in something bigger than themselves. I think it's what's so valuable about the studio system, and it's what we try and replicate.
Take one more.
Playing nice. I want to thank David again for coming. It was a remarkable evening.